All right, let's now talk about training neural networks with multiple layers. So here on the right-hand side, I'm showing you a so-called multilayer perceptron, which is sometimes also called, or it's a feed-forward neural network, and it is also a fully connected neural network. So there are two properties here describing that the data flow is like a forward, only one direction, and then it's also fully connected. That means that each unit here is fully connected to another unit. And also notice the word perceptron, although this type of network is not that closely related to the perceptron, because there's another thing going on here. It's not shown in this figure, but we have nonlinear activation functions, and what that means, we will cover this in way more detail in a future lecture, so no need to memorize that here. But yeah, so what this architecture allows us to do is now to solve the XOR problem. So the reasons why this can solve the XOR problem, even though there's only one output node here, is that it has multiple layers, and also that it has nonlinear activation functions. So these two aspects make it able to solve the XOR problem. So here I've generated some toy data, and I applied a real multilayer perceptron to this data, and I trained two multilayer perceptrons with a slightly different numbers of hidden units, and you can see in both ways the neural network came up with solutions for this XOR problem. So on the left hand side, it learned solving the XOR problem by just having these two parallel binary boundaries. I found this very interesting, to be honest. So yeah, it looked very organized and very efficient. Another way the network could solve the XOR problem was here, was shown here on the right hand side. So yeah, I just changed the number of hidden units a little bit, and you can see the solution is quite different. And of course, there are infinitely many solutions to this problem using a multilayer neural network. So we will again talk about this in way more detail later on. But if you're interested also later in this course, if you're interested in drawing neural network architecture figures, for example, for your report or proposal and so forth, here is actually a very nice tool by Alex Linnell, I think. Actually, I don't know if this is the last name or if it's related to AI or something. So I think the first name of this person is Alex, the last name, I don't know. But this is a very nice tool that lets you quickly draw simple drawings of neural networks. They also have drawings for the LINET style and AlexNet style networks, which are convolutional neural networks, which will be covered also later in this course. Moving on. So a little bit more about the multilayer neural networks. So they have now the solution to our XOR problem with the hidden layers and the nonlinear activation functions. However, there was a new problem when this network architecture was proposed, and the problem was that it was hard to train. So initially, there was no training algorithm for that. So one solution that was proposed at some point was backpropagation. So it has been proposed several independent times. So there's actually an article by Jürgen Schmidhuber who invented it first. So there are different resources or literature cited here, which you may find interesting. So it's a blog post listing all the different ways or inventors of backpropagation or things related to backpropagation. The paper that made it really popular, though, and that showed that it actually works for training multilayer perceptrons, was by Rummelhardt and Hinton in 1986. So this was an independent formulation, so they formulated it independently. So by that I mean they were not aware of the previous literature. So, and this was also the paper then that made this really popular, where because they really showed that this actually works in practice. And also, later it was shown that neural nets, such as the multilayer perceptron here with one hidden layer, if it's arbitrarily large, is able to approximate arbitrary functions. So it can approximate any arbitrary function with a certain precision if the hidden layer has a very large size. But of course, that the ability to approximate an arbitrary function doesn't mean it's easy to do that. So it's still hard to train a network in certain cases. So there are other architectures, we will learn about them later, which are suited for, or better suited for, certain types of problems. But again, this was like a big breakthrough, because now there is this algorithm for training multilayer neural networks very efficiently. And yeah, spoiler, so this algorithm is also still used in common architectures. It's still our most efficient and most popular algorithm for training neural networks. So it has stood the test of time so far. Yeah, and here's a little fun fact about the backpropagation algorithm by Rummelhardt and Hinton. So I read this in an interview book where Geoff Hinton talked about how they came up with it. So he said, in late 1985, I actually had a deal with Dave Rummelhardt that I would write a short paper about backpropagation, which was his idea, and he would write a short paper about autoencoders, which was my idea. It was always better to have someone who didn't come up with the idea write the paper, because he could say more clearly what was important. So I wrote a short paper about backpropagation, which was the Nature paper that came out in 1986, but Dave still hasn't written the short paper about autoencoders. I'm still waiting. So this was from a book, The Talking Nets. It's a little bit old, but it's still interesting if you are interested. It's like an interview book, like outlining the oral history of neural networks via interviews with people who worked on neural networks in the last century. And then there was also another interesting book, Architects of Intelligence. It's more recent, from, I think it's from 2018, which I read last year. It was also very entertaining. It's like a lot of interviews also with Geoff Hinton and many other people who are famous deep learning researchers. So it was another enjoyable read. So if you're interested for pleasure reading, this is actually particularly a fun book, because also they ask everyone to give a prediction when AI can be invented, and there's no clear consensus. So some people say the artificial general intelligence that I talked about last lecture will never be invented. Some think it's like 100 years old and so forth. So it was actually an interesting read. I kind of like that. Okay. Yeah, backpropagation is not the only algorithm for parameterizing neural networks, such as the multilayer perceptron. So there are other types of algorithms. So here, this is from a paper by Lillycrap, Santoro, Maris, Ackerman, and Hinton, where they discussed backpropagation and the brain, basically discussing how similar the learning algorithm in a human brain could be to backpropagation. Of course, we don't know the answer yet. We know that the brain is probably not using the backpropagation that we are using for training neural networks. However, it may use something that is somewhat similar to backpropagation. But I don't want to go into a discussion about neuroscience and how similar it is to how the human brain works. But what I found interesting is here this brief overview of the different types of learning algorithms that we could use for training a neural network. So for example, there would be Hebbian learning. So say you are interested in this node here, updating this connection here. Hebbian learning does not involve feedback. So with feedback here is meant that if you do a prediction and then you look at the error, you usually update the network such that the error is minimized. But if there's no feedback, it's not really minimizing the error. What happens in Hebbian learning is that the connection is strengthened the more often it is used for making a prediction. So it's not necessarily improving the error. You can think of it maybe if you are playing, if you're playing tennis and you make a wrong move, but no one teaches you that it is wrong, and you make the move more often and more often and more often. So if you repeatedly make the wrong move in tennis and no one teaches you that this is wrong, it will be harder to unlearn it later. And it doesn't mean you become better at tennis if you do a wrong move that is not hitting the ball over the over the net, for example. So another type of learning is perturbation learning. So you make a perturbation, like you perturb a weight and see if it's better or not. If it's better, then you keep the weight, otherwise you discard it. It's also not very efficient. This is actually very, very slow. Backpropagation is actually very efficient, and it's also very good for minimizing the error. So there's another type of learning algorithm where it's similar to backpropagation, but instead of doing backpropagation, like backpropagating the errors, it's involving a second network. But according to their paper also, they admit that backpropagation is the most efficient algorithm for minimizing the error, although it may not be what the human brain uses. But in practice, when we develop computers and predictive algorithms, we care about low error, good predictions, and so forth. So that's why we are still using backpropagation, because we haven't found anything yet that works better than backpropagation. But this was just a short overview. In this course, of course, when we talk about neural networks, we will be focused on backpropagation. Here was a nice figure I just saw this weekend from a paper discussing relational inductive biases and other types of biases. So I like this figure because it kind of outlines the different types of neural network architectures that are commonly used. So we have our multilayer neural network, our multilayer perceptron that I briefly talked about in this video. And here we assume that the data columns are independent. So this would be a network that you can use with a tabular data set that we discussed in the previous week. So for example, when you think back of your iris data set where you have iris flowers, up to 150 iris flowers, and then you had the sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width, and then a class label. So this would be something as an input to the multilayer perceptron. And it doesn't really matter in what order these columns are. I mean, once you train the network, of course, then the order matters because it was trained on this table. But before training, it doesn't matter whether, let's say, the sepal length is here. It could be, you can have actually the petal width here and the sepal length here. There's no difference. You could learn the same network if the columns are in a different order. So there is no assumption about dependence of these features. In contrast, so-called convolutional networks, I will introduce them in the next video. Convolutional neural, let me abbreviate it, nets. They have one assumption, that is locality. There's another assumption, equivariance, feature equivariance. But focusing on the locality now, it's basically assuming there's some structure. This is usually used for image analysis because you can think of it as neighboring pixels are being related to each other, for example. So if you have an image of a person, so you have, let's say, two eyes, nose, and a face, so these pixels are clearly related because they all include the eye, right? So shuffling these pixels, putting one pixel up here, for example, doesn't really make sense. So in that way, there's some locality assumption. So here, in terms of relational inductive biases, you can think of the assumption you make of the data when you use a certain architecture. Or there is something called a recurrent neural network. And this one assumes, for example, if these are, that's actually a little bit maybe unfortunate. I'm not sure why these arrows are pointing down. Would maybe be more clear if they would be pointing up as the inputs. In any case, so this would be an assumption where you assume the inputs are sequentially related. So there's an order relationship, a sequential relationship. So recurrent neural networks are thus useful for text where you have words in a certain order. It wouldn't make sense to shuffle words in a sentence because then a sentence wouldn't make sense anymore. In the same way, it doesn't make sense to shuffle pixel in an image because then you lose the relationship between the images. Multilayer perceptron doesn't have such an assumption. So in that way, it is very powerful. You can learn a lot of things. I just briefly mentioned that it can be regarded as a universal function approximator. However, of course, it's also more challenging if you don't have any prior assumptions. So in that way, leveraging these prior assumptions, such as locality or sequentiality, can actually make the learning easier. And that is also one of the key ideas behind deep learning. I will, in the next video, talk about deep learning, how deep learning evolved from simple multilayer networks. Okay, lastly, there's a last architecture here. It's called specified. But of course, this is not a particular neural network architecture. This is here referring to the fact that someone hand codes things, how things are related. And this is something that I I don't think is easily be implemented, so you would have to hand code this, which is very tedious. So something like that is currently not used in practice in deep learning. So usually we use recurrent neural networks and convolutional networks for images and text, and for tabular data we can use multilayer perceptrons. Okay, so in the next lecture I will briefly talk about deep learning, the origin of the name, and some developments, how deep learning evolved from multilayer networks.